We're so pleased this evening to welcome to Oregon State University Dr. George Wittenstein and his wife, Dr. Crystal Bianchi. I've rarely met someone more broadly educated and interested than Dr. Wittenstein. He's licensed in cardiosurgery, vascular surgery, thoracic surgery, and pediatric surgery. He has a PhD in medicine, a PhD in psychotherapy, and he would have had a PhD in philosophy had not his supervising professor, also a member of the White Rose, been captured and killed by the Germans. Some years ago, in a BBC interview, famed Holocaust survivor Elie Wiesel was asked to explain how such a tragedy could have happened. In his response, he observed that, quote, "The Germans were the perfect killers, and the Jews were the perfect victims." While Wiesel sought to explain the almost incomprehensible death machine of the Nazi dictatorship, we have learned that not all Jews were perfect victims. Many of you were here last year when Toivy Blatt, a survivor of an armed resistance escape from Sobibor death camp, spoke to us. And this night, we have Dr. George Wittenstein, who represents the many Germans who were increasingly appalled by the horrors of the Hitler regime and sought to resist and overthrow a party which had led their beloved Germany down a path of degradation and shame. As a medical student at the University of Munich, Dr. Wittenstein and others formed a small resistance group later that came to be known as the White Rose. When most of the key members were caught and killed by the Nazi army, Dr. Wittenstein was fighting or volunteered to fight on the German front, a place that he could be safe from the Gestapo. While there, he treated wounded soldiers as a medic, and he smuggled their guns back to Munich, where Freedom Action Bavaria, or he assisted in smuggling the guns back to Munich, where Freedom Action Bavaria, another resistance group who saved the city of Munich, was headquartered. All of these events should have cost him his life, but through a series of events, he was preserved. And we are honored to hear him speak tonight about the dark days when opposition to the Nazi regime met death for most of his associates. After the war in 1948, Dr. Wittenstein immigrated to the United States and has had a distinguished career as a practitioner and professor of surgery at the universities of Colorado and Denver and California at Santa Barbara, where he and his wife, also a renowned medical professor, now reside. They are the parents of 4 children and 11 grandchildren. Please welcome Dr. George Wittenstein.
Thank you, Professor Sherrier, for your very kind introduction. I would like to apologize to the audience for sitting, but my back won't let me stand for more than a few minutes. I see to my enjoyment how many young people are in the audience. And I must tell you that I envy you. I envy you because you had never had to go through the experience of living in a country that is ruled by a dictatorship. You cannot imagine what this means, and I hope you will never experience it. I want to direct my attention first to all of those of you who are young. In other words, you are younger than the baby boom generation. I would like to talk now only to those who are in their teens and 20s. And I'd like you to forget for a few minutes, if you can, and please do so. Imagine the following. Here you are, a student at the university, or a working person, or a high school student, and you hear it is the year of the election of the country you're living in, and you suddenly hear on the radio or on television or read in a paper that a party has won that you don't know much about, except you know that what you've seen on the streets, the rowdies, they beat up people who have different parties. And now suddenly they're in power. And before you know it, you haven't read about it yet, but you learn in a few days that the leaders of all other parties are either killed, murdered, or in prison overnight. And within the next few weeks, you will learn how much the country has changed. Most organizations that you either participated in or you love are gone. There are no more fraternities or sororities at the university. But now suddenly are a national student organization. You suddenly in a country where it does not affect you, but those who come after you. Every child has to be in a youth organization. It's called the Hitler Youth. 3 years later, it will advance to even younger ones. And after so and so many years of Hitler Youth, until you reach K-12, you have to serve 6 months in forced labor service. There's no way out. You have to. Regardless whether you're male or female, regardless of what you want to do with your life, this is a must. So you live in a militarily organized barracks, digging ditches or whatever the units to which you are assigned do. If you want to go to university, you cannot unless you have served those 6 months. You can never, no university will let you register. After those 6 months of forced labor service come 2 years of UMT, Universal Military Training, like we had in this country for a few years. If you are lucky, you can postpone your training in the Army or Air Force or Navy for a year or two and could start your course of studies or training, whatever your future profession will be. But you don't know whether you may not be called out in the middle of this to serve your 2 years. You will soon learn how everything in life has changed. On Fridays, you have to eat, and your mother has to cook for you a one dish, one pot dish called Einkaufs. And the money that's saved by doing this will go to certain organizations. There is no more free rides in most things that you could go to, but there are new free rides. If you belong to a uniformed Nazi organization, said Nazi because it could have been something else. Then you get preferential admission to theaters or concerts. And you will learn that life has become strangely restricted. It's wide open to you if you join one of the organizations that the new government has started. But you also miss people whom you've known. They're suddenly gone. They're in concentration camps. You will learn that the armed forces, for whom you have to give 2 years of your life, have changed dramatically. The leader of the party that won the election very cleverly changed the oath that any young soldier, future soldier, has to do when he's inducted. You no longer swear an oath that you will be living, working, fighting for your fatherland. No. You swore an oath on the one person who is at the zenith of that organization. He is called Führer. You realize that everything is in the hands of this party, because the party decides who is in the government and who the government is and what the government decides. And you pretty soon realize that there is absolutely no way out. There is no way to resist. Because the government has the power to spy on everything you do. As a small child in school, you will be exhorted by the teachers to denounce your own parents if they say anything against the government. I've seen myself that in a movie theater, just like in the United States, the film usually was preceded by a weekly show, weekly news show, because television did not exist then yet. And in most of these weekly shows, the new leader of the country gives a brief speech. And suddenly, 2 rows ahead of me in the theater, a man appeared and picked somebody in the audience and took him away to police, Gestapo, secret police. Because this man had said, seeing the leader's face on the screen, said something obviously detrimental about this person, or derogatory. So somebody in the audience heard him say this, told the secret police, and he was carted away. Now I want you to think, what would you do if you were in this situation? What would you do to get rid of this elected government? Please raise your hands with a good idea. Don't forget, telephones are tapped, the press is not free, radio is all controlled by this and censored by the government. What can you do to change things? Please, I see a hand back there. Did you say riot? I can hear the word, sorry. Pray, yes. Will it get you anywhere? It may be good for your heart, but not for the community and the country. Any other good ideas? Yes, sir.
I mean,
I don't see very many hands. Would you all just give in and kowtow and hope and pray that miracles will happen in the country we go? You'll move to another country. No, this was possible, of course. You could move to any country you wanted to. If you could find a country that would take you, and if you would have the money to for your transportation to the country, and a work permit in the other country. Difficult to achieve, some people have, yes. Much worse, I'll be with you in a second, much worse if you happen to be a group of people racially determined by your government, such as Jews or some other groups, even homosexuals, it would be very difficult for you. Yes, you could. It's very effectual if you hit with it, but it's very hard to hit too many policemen and troopers and soldiers. We can get there. You love your country. You want the best for your country. You don't want to see your country go to pot. Anybody any good idea? Yes. That's indeed a very good suggestion. What I did not mention is, I mentioned in passing, that the government censors and controls almost everything. So in order to organize a resistance movement, you need communication. And communication, at that point, was extremely difficult. You never knew whether your telephone was tapped. You never knew whether your mail was read. Communication was really only possible individually, two persons meeting, preferably somebody whom you know, and about whose political leanings you happen to know, somebody whom you could trust. Because as I was trying to demonstrate with the poor guy who was arrested during a movie show, you really couldn't trust anybody. It so happened that a cousin of mine, who was in this youth organization, which I never joined, but he did, and he became convinced that this was the best in the world. He told me one day that he would go and denounce his own father. He said to me, you know, think for a moment about the consequences. Your father would probably be put in a concentration camp, which means your family, the mother, would lose any financial support. What are you going to live on? How are you going to eat? So he had second thoughts, thank God. But this was the consequence for most people who tried to do something about it. Any other good ideas? You go to what? But that's what most people did. And I'm taking a question that has not been asked ahead of time. I've been asked many times, how come that so many professors and teachers at universities participated? The answer is very simple. Private universities did not exist in Germany. They were all state-owned. So anybody who worked at a university, whether he was a cleaning person or the head professor, were employees of the state. If they had any thought which they spoke out, they lost their job. And with the job, they lost their pension. And for a German at that time, the worst thing that could happen is lose your pension. So this is why virtually all professors participated. They became party members to protect their own hire, to protect their jobs. Anybody else has a good idea? I didn't get everything you said, but it sounded like a good idea. I think I gave you an impression of how difficult it was to get any organization started which opposed the publicly, democratically elected government. Because the government now is all powerful and is really nothing one could do single-handedly. The only true organization which could have done something were the armed forces. And I just told you why this was impossible, because their oath was that sworn on their protect the fatherland, but to protect the leader, the Führer. And this is why the armed force did nothing. Yes, one could try assassination. To my knowledge, there have been 23 verified attempts to, now I mention the name Hitler, but I wanted you to be in a situation which had nothing to do with Nazi Germany. Just I tried to put you in a situation where you were faced with problems like this. They all failed, either because of luck or poor planning. Until in the last year of the war, they tried and failed miserably. Well, a group of young students, all of them, with one exception, were medical students, came to the same conclusion, that one had to do something. But what would be, could be something. Let me tell you how it started. I, like everybody else who wanted to pursue an academic career or go to university, had to sooner or later serve 2 years in the army, and an interesting thing happened, that all those who wanted to become physicians, to study medicine, were pulled out of whatever troop they were in and collected in barracks as future medical students, because the army, the armed forces, needed physicians. So they stayed soldiers, but they were grouped together, and in typical Prussian fashion, a march to the university in the morning and back in the evening, which of course was, didn't work, because every student had different hours and different courses they had to go to. So they gave it up very soon, and you could find your own places to where you wanted to live, except every Saturday you had to go to a roll call at the same barracks. And also it's difficult to study when there are up to 12 people in one room. Well, before we were permitted to study medicine, they made medics out of us. We had to go to a hospital, an army hospital, and train to be a medic for 6 months. And when you live closely quartered and go to the same places, you, of course, find that some of the co-students you like, some you don't like, some you hope has similar ideas. This was not easy to find out. Sniffed at someone maybe for a couple of months till you realized maybe you could talk to him and find somebody with similar ideas. This happened to me, this was 1938. One of my co-future medics, future medical students, was a highly intelligent young man from Russia. His father was German, his mother was Russian. They fled the Russian Revolution and came to Munich. And he said to me, jokingly one day, "Well, when all this is over, hopefully there'll be a plaque at the door of this room in which the 12 of us slept studying. There will be a plaque saying this is where the movement continued." Now this makes no meaning to you. I come to that in a second. It was later translated, and in the literature you find it that this plaque reads, "This is where the revolution began." No, we didn't call it quite that way. But in German, the word movement has two meanings. Bewegung, that's the German word for it, has two meanings. Something moves. But it also means an idea that people accept and do together. This is why Hitler was liked Munich so much. Because this is where the Nazi ideology was started and began. Munich was called the capital of the movement, Hauptstadt der Bewegung. So this meaning that my friend said was, had a very clever double meaning. This is where the movement continued, but of course not what one would think automatically by the same. There were, and I'm trying to put away some misconceptions, the White Rose was not an organization. It was not where you got a membership card or a number. It was nothing, and really nothing, but several individual close-knit friendships between two people. And if you take three, double, you have at least six already of original participants in the White Rose. These were true friends. They had the same interests. They went to the same theater plays. They all were interested in music. They went to the same non-medical lectures. They went to the same theater shows. And eventually, in the course of time of years, these three individual double friendships joined together and became the center, the root of what later was called the White Rose. And I cannot emphasize this enough. These were young people with common interests in art, music, philosophy, and on the side, medicine. So the day came when we discussed amongst ourselves what could be done about this. How could Germany be saved from a terrible end, which was obviously would come, even if there had been no war. The plans of government for the future of Germany were horrible. Then other things began, that Jews were mistreated, were more and more, step by step, by law, restricted from activities that a normal citizen can expect to do. Most of this went unrecognized by the majority. The first concentration camp was started as early as 1934 and served for one purpose only, to eliminate anybody who was a danger to the government and to society as such. Many in concentration camps were there not for political reasons. And then one day the building of the government, the parliament, burned down. Immediately propaganda claimed this was the enemies of the National Socialists, these were Jews and so, and which is not true. It was a single person, a Dutchman, who did this. Of course he was immediately put to death. But the propaganda used this event to push laws through parliament, which the Nazis wanted, which to enact, and no, they did not have the number of voices, of votes in the parliament, but this was a wonderful reason, of course, for all parties vote for all these new recommendations that were introduced. It's, in retrospect, very interesting to see how well organized this was. Within 2 days after they officially came to power, that all the leaders of parties that were disliked were either killed, murdered, or arrested. This was planned years before they took over power. This went into many, many minute details. It's extraordinary when you look at later what was discovered, how well this was planned. Became quite obvious to those who could think that this was a coming disaster for the country and its citizens. Those who could left Germany. For Jews it was a lot more difficult. This may come as a surprise to you, that Germany was not an anti-Semitic country, anti-Semitic population. Sure, anti-Semitism exists in the entire world, but not so in Germany, to a very small degree. The reason for this is in Germany, Jews were completely integrated in the German society. In art, in culture, in music, in theater, in medicine, in science, a very high proportion of leading people were Jewish. But they didn't consider themselves Jews. They were Germans. I'll give you an example. One Jew who emigrated in time to the United States became very wealthy. About 5 years ago, he moved back to Berlin, the capital of Germany. He has a huge art collection, which he wanted to give to the city. And the city was not very interested in it. So he built a museum, a private museum, in Berlin to house his huge collection, and built himself a house on the same street opposite the museum. And American reporters asked him, why on earth did you do this? Why did you go to Germany, give them your art, after all what Germany had done to Jews? He said, the answer is very simple. I am a German. This was the feeling of German Jews. And this went through all layers of society. I grew up in the country, and at that time, cattle trade was in the hands of Jews, which of course it was taken away from them very soon, 1934 or 5 probably. And when the peasants were asked, said, I wish we had our Jewish cattle trader back, at least he was honest. This was the feeling and sentiment through virtually all layers of society in Germany. I'm going back to stating that to avoid any misunderstanding, the White Rose was not an organization. It was friends. And because, for reasons that I hopefully made you understand earlier this evening, I said, to do anything else you need communication. Communication was virtually impossible, especially once the war started. Each train was patrolled by standard, regular police and by secret and military police. So any male between the ages of 18 and 50 who traveled not in uniform and without official travel papers became immediately suspect to being AWOL. So another difficulty in communication. We decided that the only hope to accomplish anything outside of assassination, but how can an ordinary citizen assassinate somebody who's surrounded by hundreds of secret police and never one-to-one or close by, was to educate the German population into what the government really planned for them, hoping they would come to their senses and one day would stand up. So how can you do this? Radio, without the question. Television, Germany had already television then, but it was except the less possible. It was a very small area that had television. Newspapers, no way. You could communicate with anybody. So the plan was made to print, to write and print leaflets, which would be distributed by mail or by messenger, with the hopes that as many similar cells would be founded at as many universities as possible, who then in turn would either reproduce these leaflets or write their own. And that's how it all started. You must not forget that war had started. Germany had, to the surprise of everybody, been eminently successful, conquering in a few months most of Europe. So all of Europe has become a virtual prison for everybody who lived there, German citizen or not. You could not travel, you could not escape, because at the border you would not permitted to leave the country without a special permit issued by the government. So every German, whether citizen or not, lived in a prison. And in the beginning it looked great because the German armies were so successful everywhere. In their blitzkriegs, they, in a few weeks, a few months, subjugated virtually all of Europe, except for one or two countries that managed to keep outside, like Sweden, and Switzerland, of course, which for political reasons Germany did not dare to attack, although the Swiss were very well prepared for a possible war to defend themselves. But there were problems that we didn't think of. This was war, everything controlled. You could not go in the store and buy a ream of paper. If you're lucky, you could buy maybe 100 sheets. Same thing, if you went to post office to buy 100 stamps, you became immediately suspicious. Why would the average person need 100 stamps? How do you make 10, 100, maybe 1,000 leaflets out of one typewriter? You can make 6 copies if you're lucky. If you have a mimeograph, which most of you have never seen, it's a nice machine which was standard before photocopying was invented. And of course, modern copy machines, which are ideal, just press a button and you have 100 copies. So you need a mimeograph machine where you have to type a matrix and then put it in the machine, then by hand cranking, make one copy after the other. How could you buy this machine? You didn't need it for your job. Your job is to be a student. Well, eventually, somebody managed to get a copy machine, which made it possible to produce the leaflets in small editions of 100, 200. One reached over 1,000. They, in order to avoid detection, they were mailed from different post office boxes all over the city of Munich. And many were transported to other cities and mailed there, even in Austria. So the Gestapo would not think, oh, well, they're all coming from Munich, and would put everybody in Munich under observation. So in the first 2 months, May and June, 5 leaflets were produced. Pardon me, 4. In rapid sequence and distributed. Then the government was faced with an odd problem, namely, in summer, 3 months of vacation at universities. So the people in power found themselves suddenly with thousands of medical students in uniform, except for the female students, and 3 months in the summer without anything to do. They didn't come to the conclusion for 2 years that if at universities they would introduce trimesters instead of semesters, they could produce a physician a year sooner. And they need physicians badly. Not until 1944 did they change the system. So what to do with thousands of medical students in uniform? Well, it came to the great idea to ship us all to Russia as medics. And incredible waste of time and money and material. And it was for most of us an interesting experience, harrowing in many ways. It gave a few of us the opportunity to see what the Germans had done in countries like Poland and Russia, how people were treated. Gave me personally the opportunity to visit the ghetto and lodge. Now, you couldn't get in, but we could go to the entrance, and I observed at the entrance what happened. And you will see this later in photo. The male people who were incarcerated in the ghetto, who could work, were permitted to work in factories or so in lodge, and had to come back, of course, in the camp at night. If they were lucky, they could scrounge some food during the day and bring it in a sack on their back. And they were checked at the entrance if they had anything in their sack, which the authorities didn't like. They threw it out. Well, destroyed it. And interesting enough, the ghetto was guarded by Ukrainians. Ukraine was a Russian province that was favored by Germans, because they were anti-Russian, naturally, because of what the Russians had done to them. So there were thousands of Ukrainians in German uniforms fighting the Russians. And I got a lot of information from some of them. One Ukrainian officer told me he'd been here in Poland only a few days, that he was stationed in Lithuania, and that his troops helped to eliminate 21,000 Lithuanian Jews. I never saw executions of Jews or others, but one day I was in an ambulance, came through a forest in Russia. We were stopped, and there came a column of trucks full of people, disappeared in the forest. Then we heard shooting, and the trucks came back empty. So it was obvious to me what was going on. These were mass executions of probably Jews, or maybe some Russians that fought against the Germans. When we came back from Russia, I could tell you a lot about our experience in Russia, our studies continued, the situation became more desperate. 2 more leaflets were produced and distributed, and Hans Scholl, let's go back a second, the first leaflet was written by Alexander Schmorell. That's the student I mentioned with whom I became a close friend. His parents had emigrated from Russia. And the other leaflets were written by Scholl and Schmorell together. The last leaflet was written entirely by Professor Huber. I have to go back in one point. There were, as I mentioned, certain professors which were very great favorites by students, even if they didn't teach something that the students were particularly interested in. But they were professors who were relatively frank in what they said, even at risking their own jobs or their lives. Like, I'll never forget how Professor Huber, in one of his lectures, started a lecture about Heinrich Heine, one of the greatest German poets. But unfortunately, even though he lived 150 years ago, he was a Jew. So you couldn't even mention the name Heine in Nazi Germany. This professor began a lecture, full hour lecture on Heine, one of these terrible, distasteful Jews, who horrible Heine was, and how bad his poems were. At the end of his lecture, Heine was one of the greatest German poets. It was incredibly well done. Huber was an extraordinary person. He taught music because he was the greatest scientist of folk music in Germany. So one subject that he was permitted to teach was music. The other one was philosophy and psychology. And that was my field because I wanted to become a psychotherapist. And the other professor was Fritz Joachim von Rentzen, to whom his lectures, many, many students came who had nothing to do with the field that he was teaching, but they were interested in his lectures. He was very outspoken in what he said. Rintelen. And as I said, many of the medical students went to lectures of these two professors. One day, Rintelen did not appear at the Soviet. Wondered. There were rumors that maybe he was fired. So, and there was, but if or he was sick, but if he was sick, there would have been a note on the door that he's sick. So we, the whole group of students, about 80 to 100, decided we'll come back next week and see whether he'll give his lecture then. We all came back and he didn't appear either. So a young painter, a friend of mine, and I persuaded the whole group of students to go to the president of the university and demand an explanation, which we did. His secretary said, well, I'm sorry, we won't talk to you. So it made so much noise that students can do very well that finally the president appeared. He opened the door, a small slit. In my memory, he was chalk white because he was frightened. Said, I refuse any information, and slammed the door shut. So this friend of mine and I persuaded the other students to march to the home of the professor for a sympathy demonstration. And this happened. In the middle of the war, in broad daylight, on the main thoroughfare in Munich, here was this group of at least 80 students, at least half of them in uniform, marching along. And this pedestrian, of course, along the sidewalks, was surprised and couldn't understand what was going on. Well, I lost my mentor with whom I was quite agreed to take me on as a student to guide me for my dissertation in psychology. I had to look for another one, and I picked Professor Huber. And he graciously accepted me. And Huber, just like von Rintelen, all the people who had something to do with the White Rose or thought like we went to his lectures. He had a lot of physical impediment. He had some, I think it was, he had probably some kind of child's disease, which he was partially paralyzed. When he spoke, it was difficult for him to speak. And when he was carried away, when he was set them, then his speech suddenly became clear and easily understandable and wonderful speech. And he was totally transformed when he really liked when he was interested in what he was talking about. And we took Professor Huber into told him our secrets, our secret plans, and he participated to many evenings where plans were discussed, what do we do next, what do we do best, and so on. And he wrote a draft for a leaflet, which was the last leaflet that was printed and distributed. And if you look at the leaflets, if you read all six, the last two are completely different from the first four. I said to Hans Scholl, look, we can't go on like this. It's wonderful and nice to print leaflets that extol Nietzsche and Plato and all famous philosophers. That's not good enough. The situation is that bad in Germany, that dire, that we have to ask now for resistance. Preferably not only passive, but also active resistance. And I learned later that Professor Huber gave him the same opinion. And the last two leaflets were completely different in tone and character and content. As I mentioned, the summer all activities were interrupted for 3.5 months because we were all shipped to Russia. And then something terrible happened. Hans Scholl had told us that he had planned to maybe one day distribute leaflets inside universities. And we all told him this is crazy, too risky. We can't do it and shouldn't do it. One day, he and his sister decided they would do it without telling anybody else. And after, so Hans and Sophie, they used this golden hour in universities, German universities. All lectures begin 15 minutes after the full time, and nobody during the next 45 minutes enters or leaves the lecture room. They had 50 minutes during which they could, 45 minutes during which they could act, and they took a suitcase with them full of leaflets, put the stack in front at the entrance door to every lecture room. Then they left the building. Outside, the Donald and my dad, he has some leaflets left. They went back. And up to the university, it has a huge atrium. Went up to the top floor, and in a spontaneously sense of urgency and joy, Sophie threw a whole stack of leaflets down into the atrium. On the ground floor stood the chief janitor of the university, who happened to see him and went up and arrested Hanschel. Now, to me, the mystery begins, which will never be solved. First of all, we had an agreement that if anybody was under suspicion of being arrested, he would try to make it to a place that my family owned in the country. With an old ruin of an old castle and a huge house, everyone could easily, and this happened, my mother did this a number of times, hide some people before one had the opportunity to smuggle them out of the country. And Hansel was a young, athletic man. He could have knocked down this janitor and run away with his sister, hidden somewhere during the day, and at night with a bicycle, make it to our place where they would have been safe. They never did. Gestapo very soon discovered there were others, which they suspected, of course. It was not just two people. Nobody in the interrogation gave any names away except one person. I won't mention that. And they searched the apartment. Both girls lived together in the same apartment. And I went there the day after their arrest, looking for stuff that they had for me, books that loaned them, letters and so on. And the house was not observed. I looked very closely whether anybody was there watching. And I managed to get into the room and find what belonged to me. The younger sister of Hansel came to Munich. She went to her apartment and found a diary of her younger sister, Sophie, which the Gestapo had overlooked. I forgot to mention that in these last few months, I did mention that the leaflets changed in their makeup in what was suggested. And I said, the mystery is that Hansel never fled. Alexander Schmorell did try to flee. He did not try to make it to our home. And my wife and I found out only a few years ago, talking to Alexander Schmorell's girlfriend, who solved the mystery to us. He had come to her, burned his uniform in the boiler for the central heat in the building. He told her he was trying to flee to Russia or to Switzerland. And he tried to make it to Switzerland, but the snow was too deep, he couldn't. So he went to a place for a boarding school where he knew the chauffeur, who was a Bulgarian, who gave him his passport. He came back to Munich, and his girlfriend changed the photographs in the passport and forged the stamp. And then disaster struck. He, on his way home, there was an air raid alarm. He went to the nearest house in the air raid shelter. And a female student whom he known, who knew him, recognized him and called the police. So he was arrested right there. The most tragic thing is Christoph Probst, who was, of all the people in the world, was my closest friend. He was the only one who was married. He had two children. The third one was born while he was in prison. The Gestapo could never have in any way connected him to the White Rose, because he no longer studied in Munich. He now was in Salzburg, in another country, in Austria, and far removed from Munich. But he had penciled a draft for another leaflet. When Hans was arrested on the gallery in the university, he had this leaflet in his breast pocket. So of course the Gestapo got hold of that, compared the handwriting, had a professor's handwriting expertise, compared this with other letters that they found. So his arrest was unpreventable because nobody knew about this. Nobody would think that he would ever be brought in a connection to White Rose. I forgot to mention that preceding this, the several in the White Rose decided to paint graffiti on houses, including university, and on three nights they painted freedom, down with Hitler, Hitler mass murderer. These were the slogans that they painted, even on the outside of university, and were never caught. I painted them in the public toilets in the university building. Thought this was safest because nobody knew what you were doing when you're in the John. And they never found out who did the paintings. They were accused of it in the trial. I learned through an attorney who was a member of the elite of the Nazi Party, but in reality was an anti-Nazi, that the Gestapo was on my trail, and he helped me in an incident that would go into too much, many details, would take up too much time, how I avoided severe consequences. She denounced me at the Gestapo, and fortunately I was able to get out of this investigation without going into too many details here. the Gestapo then turned the documents over to the army, and about 8 months later I faced the court martial. It was not much pressure. I had, as a matter of fact, it was worse than the Gestapo interrogation. By law, Gestapo did not have the right to arrest members of the armed forces. In the case of the White Rose, they did. Another case where they did too. The commander of our unit of student company, I don't know whether he was a Nazi or not, but to him I know he was mad, madder than hell, that Gestapo had arrested a soldier to which they did not have the right. And he behaved in a really remarkable way for the rest of the war. He tried to protect anybody he could in his company. As a matter of fact, when a good friend of ours was taken to the Gestapo, he went with him to try to protect him as much as possible during that interrogation. And here, I'm jumping beyond. This attorney one day warned me that the Gestapo had found new material on me and it would be best for me to disappear. Well, where can you disappear in a country that you can't leave? Well, there was one place we were safe, and that was actually the front. Because the Gestapo had not have, after the White Rose affair, Gestapo was empowered to arrest soldiers, but not at the front. So I volunteered for the front and spent the rest of the war in Italy. I will hurry, there's not much more to say, except I leave as much time as you want for questions and answers. The same attorney told me that he learned that the People's Court would come to Munich. That is very unusual. Hitler created a People's Court, Volksgericht in German, for one purpose only, and this is to eliminate his enemies. And if you see that film tomorrow, you will see how this court handled matters. The president, most cruel and terrible way, he just screamed at the defendants, didn't let them say anything. It was just terrible to watch this. Well, when these two, Hans and Sophie, were arrested, all of us were called back to the barracks and told by the commander we would have to stay there until matters had resolved, that unfortunately a member, he didn't mention names, a member of our company had been arrested as committing high treason. To me that meant only one thing, namely that Hans Scholl and his sister were arrested. And at that meeting, Alex Morel did not show up. Now this happened many times, because during roll call, many of us in the White Rose didn't go. One of us always was there and shouted here when the names were read. And with several hundred, of course, the sergeant would never know who had said yes. So I asked the commander, look, Alex Morel has rented a room out in the country so he could study free of air raids, and I know where he lives, he has no telephone. If you let me go, I will get on my bicycle and get him, which of course was all a lie. I went to his father's office, he's a physician, and fully expecting the Gestapo man sitting in the waiting room. Indeed, there was one. And I, and while I was in his office, he made as much noise as he could with a hammer on an anvil, and told him to please, if his son had any way to contact him, without mentioning names, to remind him of our agreement where to flee to. And unfortunately, he didn't do that. So when I learned through the same attorney that the People's Court would come to Munich, I said, well, this can be only for Scholl and Schmorell and others in the White Rose. And I called the parents Scholl immediately, fully realizing that the telephone call would be listened to. Please come to Munich. Tomorrow, your children will be tried by the People's Court. And I'll meet you at the railroad station, which I did, fully aware that some Gestapo agent would travel with them, incognito, and seeing whom they would meet. But I had no choice. They had to know what was going on. And I guided the parents to the Palace of Justice, where they managed to get in and observe part of the trial. If I had not done this, they would never have seen their children again, because within 4 hours of the trial, they were executed. And I was just warned that we better close. I can only say there are sure many questions in your minds. I don't know how many minutes you can give us. Yeah. As far as I'm concerned, an hour.
There were several movies made about the White Rose, as you know, of course. Which of those movies do you think is the most accurate?
The most accurate and best probably was the second one by a man named Verhoeven, who made several other films in the United States. This film that you're going to see tomorrow is quite good. It is not accurate. There are many mistakes in it. I had a 1 hour discussion with the scriptwriter, who praised and was very proud of the endless research he had done. And he wrote a book about that film, and it was sold when the film was shown. And I can assure you that most of his research is either not correct or wrongly interpreted.
Thank you for the question.
The main objective of this film is that Christoph Probst is pictured as a wimp, and he definitely was not a wimp. I told the director at this meeting that this was a grave mistake, and he said yes, he realizes that he didn't picture him quite the way he was, but then he said, but I think in the last few scenes of the film I made up for that. Well, he never did.
Yes.
The only public opinion that I heard was when doing a lecture, it was announced by the people in the university that two students had been arrested for anti-government policies. Students in sitting a few rows ahead of me said loudly, they should be hung from the trees in front of the university.
Yes. The question was, does Dr. Wittenstein feel that the pamphlets had an effect on people's attitudes?
Well, I must say that for almost 20 years, I thought that everything we had done and sacrificed so many lives was in vain, and we accomplished nothing. It was a very depressing conclusion. Now, 50 years later, looking at young and talking to younger German students, a generation later, maybe really two generations later, I think it had a definite late effect, that students have more and more come to the conclusion how important it is for a person, for an individual, to stand up for your own opinion, to live your convictions, regardless of the consequences, which is a very un-German attitude, because ever since the 18th century, and especially under Bismarck, the 19th century, late 18th century, 19th century, Germans were drilled from early childhood on to, if somebody whistles, then you stand still and obey. And that has, thank God, has almost completely disappeared.
Yes, we'll take a couple more questions, sir.
You mentioned the near impossibility of communication, but were you aware of any other resistance groups in Germany or Europe?
For those in the back, the question is, if communication was so difficult, were they aware of other resistance groups that were operating in Germany?
We were not, except for a small group of military people who had given some plans to post-war Germany. They were all connected loosely with the 20th of July movement of the generals and so on who were executed. We had a connection with them. This group had planned to have a man by the name of Gerdeler, the new Chancellor of Germany, and we had a loose connection to them, which all came to naught, of course. I have, because of the difficulty in that I mentioned and emphasized in communication, I did not learn until, maybe 20 years ago, when a Jewish temple and a synagogue in Santa Barbara showed a map, which is still there on the wall, showing all places in Germany where there was a resistance movement, a resistance group, over 300. None of them knew of each other because of the problem of communication.
Excellent question.
Much more, as I should have said, Professor Cater at the University of Toronto has done extensive research on youth under Hitler, and the title of the book is Hitler Jugend, Hitler's Youth. But he has found a material of young Germans in their late teens, in the early 20s, what they had done against Nazis is 100 times more than we in the White House ever did.
Thank you.
There's another question.
Yes.
Yes. In the name of state security, we have tortured people in this country. I'm curious of your feelings. Do we need to prosecute those people?
The question was that in the name of state security, our country has tortured people. Does Dr. Wittenstein feel that those people responsible should be prosecuted?
Yes. Now, I have to add something, though. You speak of American law, of course. In Germany, the way German law was constituted until a few years ago, absolutely no. Because Germans were obliged to follow any order, regardless of what it said. Here, I agree with you 100%.
Last question. Yes, Mary? The question was, were the leaflets designed to be sent and received by certain groups or to the general population?
They were directed primarily to academics, students, and teachers, professors, in the hope that they would understand better, that they have the same secret sympathies, and would be most able to pursue the idea and produce leaflets of their own.
They're trying to get the pictures up on the screen, so let's take another question. Yes, ma'am. Sir. Yes, ma'am. Sir. Sorry. And I don't have my glasses on either. Again, for those in the back who can't hear, the question is directed to the front. The question was, does Dr. Wittenstein regret any of his actions regarding the White Rose or other resistance activities?
I want to go more on the aspect of, would he have done anything differently?
Excuse me. Would he have done something differently than he did?
No, I have no regrets what we did. I have some regrets about some actions that some of my friends did, which were unnecessary and endangered their lives and eventually cost them their lives. These were avoidable. But I personally would not do anything differently today or tomorrow.
Yes. The question is, how did he discover the Liberation Bavaria movement and make arrangements to help smuggle guns?
Oh, you didn't get to the subject.
Yes, I know.
Okay, very briefly, I'm sorry, someone got cut short. This is the only successful military putsch in modern German history. To make it very, very brief, if it's possible, a young captain, who was severely wounded in the Russian war, was made commander of a unit that trained interpreters for the armed forces. And he managed to keep in Munich those that were definitely anti-Nazis. The others were sent wherever they had to be sent. And he planned a takeover, which he did, and did it in an extraordinary way. When the American army were close to the borders of Bavaria, that's a state in southern Germany, with Munich's capital, he had all his men come in the morning, stand up, and he revealed to them his plan. He said, we're going to, I told him what he was going to do, and those who do not want to participate, I will not ask you to go with me. As a matter of fact, I will, at this moment, discharge you from the army. Go home. Not a single person did that. They all went with him. Then he went and occupied the main radio station in Munich, gave an appeal to the German population in Bavaria, saying one of the things, they should hang a white sheet out of the window, which of course the international sign of capitulation, on which Hitler had pronounced death penalty. Hitler had ordered all citizens of Munich to fight to the last man, to destroy everything. Dr. Gango is the name, is the name of this officer, said in his appeal to the people of Munich, take prisoner of men, as many Nazis as you can. If you cannot do this, write down their names so they will not be forgotten. They went out and removed the mines in all the bridges. Not a single bridge in Munich was destroyed. Many people were indeed, big Nazis were arrested. There were gunfights. A total of almost 60 people on both sides died. He had won over a commander of a tank battalion. So it was an amazing undertaking. And Munich was saved from total destruction.
Yes, ma'am. The question is, you mentioned that there was little anti-Semitism in Germany before the Nazis took over. How do you explain the extraordinary anti-Semitism of the party?
How to explain anti-Semitism?
The anti-Semitism that took over Germany when there wasn't much anti-Semitism before.
What was Hitler doing? He was, for a political party to come to power, they need a scapegoat. Because some of the other parties did very well. And what most people in this hall probably don't know, that before 1932, Germany had an amazingly talented German foreign minister by the name of Stresemann. And he had achieved single-handedly that the Allies were seriously considering returning the German colonies in Africa to Germany. So Germany was on the best way to become integrated in a modern Europe. As a matter of fact, there was an organization called Pan-Europa, which means Pan-Europe, started by an Austrian count. And of all parties that existed, it was a party that was supranational. Members of any state in Europe were members. As a matter of fact, the total number of members of the idea of pan-Europe exceeded the number of all communists, which were the largest parties in Europe in the 30s, which is now, 50 years later, finally with United Europe has come about in a very cumbersome way. I mentioned two professors that students went to because of their really hidden political opinions. This is the first one I mentioned, is Professor Fritz Joachim von Renten, who was in 1940 already removed from his chair and reinstated in a different universe by the Americans after the war. This is how he looked a few years before his death. Same person, good friend of mine. This is the young painter student I mentioned. He and I together organized this sympathy march of students after von Rintelen was deposed. This is a picture of young Professor Huber. And this is when he is in his last year of life. This picture you've probably seen, this is the most famous of all pictures of the White Rose. There isn't a paper in the world that has not, at one time or another, shown this picture. On the left-hand side, you see Hans Scholl, next to him, his sister. And on the right, Christoph Probst. This is saying goodbye at the railroad station in Munich, on our way to Russia. And people that you can see on the left-hand side, facing the camera, is a young student by name Furtwängler. He was a close friend of almost all of us in the White Rose, but he did not know what we were doing. He was the one who was interrogated by the Gestapo, and where our commander went with him to protect him. The next one is Hans Scholl. The one turning over is another student in the student company who had nothing to do with it, but he just happened to be there. On the right, with this, our back to this, Alexander Schmorell, and at the gate is Sophie Scholl. It was on the morning we were leaving for Russia. This is the best picture I have of Christoph Probst in a lecture room, smoking a pipe. This is Alex Borrell. This is Willy Graf, whom I have not mentioned, because he really came to the White Rose very, very late, just before we went to Russia. He had bad luck. He was not transferred from the troop to a student company. So he fought the war as a fighting soldier in the West and later even in Poland. And only in 1944 was he transferred to our student company. He was very serious. He was probably, of all that I know of associated with White Rose, the one who was most clearly thinking, most incorrupt in any way. As a young student, high school student, he had a little book in which he had all the men students in his class by name. He crossed out their names when of anyone who joined the Hitler Youth. This is later, a few years later, in the army, when he really was a fighting soldier, both in West and East Germany. This is a picture at the ghetto, the end of the ghetto, and you see this one officer standing alone in the center with his back, but you can see that huge horsewhip that he used to beat any returning Jew returning from work just at his pleasure whenever he wanted to do this. The other officer at the center is here, he's kicking a Jew in the behind. Any Jew coming by whose looks he didn't like, or when they carried something in the hassle, he kicked. This is a plaque put on a house in Vyazma, a town 60 miles away from Moscow. This is as far as Napoleon got. And in memory of this event, the Germans put up the sign that Napoleon lived in this house in the year 1812. Well, none of the people who did this realized how ironic this whole thing was. But the Germans never got any farther than Napoleon did. So I don't know what they memorized. This is in the few times we had a chance to get clean. We used wash basins. As war got worse, this was the ambulance we had at the hospital I worked in, the last hospital I worked in the same city. Yes, the hospital had one or two motor-driven ambulances, which most of the time did not run because no gas. And it got so bad that in Italy, Germans didn't have any gas for their tanks. So in Italy, what they did, they dug holes for the tanks, put the tanks in those holes so they were protected. Only the gun shells were used as artillery. No gas like the tanks, but it still could be used as artillery. This gun goes, the attorney who was in charge of the company of interpreters. And this is Gangos a month before he died. This is something I didn't mention, but it shows you how pervasive and unbelievable the whole system was. Just as a young student, this picture is taken in the house which was bombed, so everything there is in ruin. And we were going through the house and the books that were lying around there. He was half Jewish. He was in the German army. He was a good soldier. He was decorated in the war in the West when France was occupied. And then he was discharged because he was half Jewish. And he was a real, true German Jew. And he never got over the fact that he was discharged because he was 50% Jewish. And he became the most rabid anti-Nazi that I ever knew personally. He was arrested a year later and tried by the People's Court. And the main reason for his death sentence by the court was that he collected money for the widow Huber. I fear to say that Mrs. Huber, when her husband was executed, applied to the university for a pension due her, which was turned down. But the argument that, sorry, but your husband is not a professor at the university, he is not a civil servant anymore. As a matter of fact, he's an enemy of the people. There's no reason why the university should pay you any pension. This poor woman starved with her two children. And if I had not collected money for her till as long as I was in Germany, she probably would have starved to death because nobody dared to help her, being the widow of a traitor, being sentenced to death by the People's Court. And one of the main reasons in the sentence of this young student for death was that he collected money for widow Huber, which he gave me, and I bought it in various ways to Mrs. Huber. It's a miracle that he never mentioned my name. That is all the pictures, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Let's give a hand to Dr. Wittenstein.
Thanks for your patience to listen.